still there. Good afternoon. I'm Brent Roussin, Manitoba's Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. The current five-day test positivity rate is 1.19%. There are 25 new cases of COVID-19 that have been identified as of 9:30 a.m. today. This brings the total number of lab-confirmed positive and probable positive cases in Manitoba to 603. Our data shows there are 7 current hospitalizations, including 3 of which are in intensive care, 218 active cases, and 377 individuals are listed as recovered. The number of deaths due to COVID-19 remains at 8. Our preliminary testing numbers show 1,817 lab tests were performed on Sunday. This brings our total testing numbers to 108,211. We're recommending that Manitobans only go for testing if you have symptoms of COVID-19 or have been directed by a healthcare provider to be tested. Testing without symptoms puts undue stress on the testing system right now. And we know that the value of a negative test in a person without symptoms is low. So we really want to focus our efforts on symptomatic individuals or those individuals who have been directed by healthcare providers to be tested. Prairie Mountain Health has updated their testing site hours operation. Visit manitoba.ca/COVID-19 for those revised hours. Preliminary information for today shows that a majority of cases in Prairie Mountain Health are contacts of known cases. The WRHA cases appear to be either travel-related or close contacts to a known case. Investigations are still ongoing. As of August 12, there are 67 cases linked to the Brandon cluster. 26 are linked to a business in Brandon, and 23 of those 26 are directly linked to that Brandon cluster. All these cases are self-isolating, and contact tracing is underway to determine close contacts. We've said for the last few days that these COVID numbers are reminding us that COVID is not done with us. We need to continue to practice those fundamentals that we always discuss. We know Manitobans are concerned with the increased numbers. Again, I reiterate that we have never been helpless against this virus. We have acted and responded in the past, and we can do the same now. These are concrete steps. These are focusing on the fundamentals. And we've become well accustomed to what those are. Staying home when you're ill, even if it's mildly unwell. Practicing good hand hygiene, not sharing items with others. Practicing physical distancing when you're outside of your household. And that means staying 2 meters, 6 feet from others outside your home. If you're unable to physically distance outside your home, then you should be wearing a mask. But if physically distancing cannot be maintained, then other precautions should be taken, including leaving that event. And then again, reiterating, Manitobans who are symptomatic should be staying at home. If you're ill, even just mildly ill, please stay home. There are a number of businesses now that are requiring masks. And we know that masks can be a useful tool in preventing the spread of COVID-19. It's certainly not the only tool, certainly not the most important tool. We know those fundamentals that we need to stick to are much more important, regardless of mask use. But if you are in a situation where physically distancing can't be obtained, then we're recommending you wear a mask. In addition to that, is if you're not sure, if you're not certain that you're going to be able to maintain that physical distancing, you should be donning a mask. So in many indoor locations, if you're not assured that you can maintain physical distancing, please wear a mask. Those that are at higher risk of the severe outcomes of COVID-19, those over age 65 or with underlying medical conditions, need to take extra caution. Need to ensure you're not in crowded places, frequent hand washing, certainly practicing physical distancing at all time. We've provided that advice of symptomatic individuals seeking testing. It is best to seek testing roughly 24 hours after the symptom onset. We know that many cases, often because symptoms are very mild, people are waiting many, many days to get tested. It's best to get that testing as early on as the symptoms develop, and preferably after 24 hours of that symptom onset is when the test is most sensitive. And so that's key to our response, ensuring we're identifying cases early, having them self-isolate, and then isolating the close contacts. And we see that these cases that we announced that are previous contacts, either related to a cluster or just to known cases, these are people who have been self-isolating. They develop symptoms while they're self-isolating, so they will not have a list of contacts. And so this is the way to, one of the best ways to control the spread of COVID. As mentioned on Monday, the COVID-19 dashboard can help provide additional information and has been updated to include health districts. There are 68 districts in Manitoba in total, 13 in Prairie Mountain Health, 24 in Southern Health, 14 in Interlake Eastern, 15 in the Northern Health Region, and 2 in the WRHA. Oh, repeat that. Yeah, so this is the 68 total districts in Manitoba, and broken down into 13 in Prairie Mountain Health, 24 in Southern Health, 14 in Interlake Eastern, 15 in Northern Health Authority, and 2 in Winnipeg Regional Health Authority. So these are made up of multiple communities and municipalities. But it's helping us provide Manitobans with a more narrowed geographic view of where cases are being identified. So Winnipeg and Brandon will continue to be reported by the whole community. Breaking down those numbers more specifically isn't really going to help the public health efforts. All Manitobans need to practice those fundamentals. So we're providing this information for the increased clarity to Manitobans to see where cases are being identified. But we don't want Manitobans to ease up on the fundamentals in areas that may not right now be showing cases. Again, we remind Manitobans to be kind to each other. That stigma is not part of our pandemic plan. Stigma adversely affects Manitoba's public health's ability to counteract this pandemic. Stigma will decrease the likelihood that people will be forthcoming with public health, and we certainly see examples of that, where stigma starts to affect people's willingness to provide a lot of information to public health because of things like shame and stigma. There is certainly no blame to people who have acquired COVID-19, and there should be no stigma on those that have acquired it or have recovered from it. We are all in this together, and the best way to battle this virus is that people can be forthcoming and we can do our full contact investigation. So please don't stigmatize individuals or businesses or even locations. Stigma is definitely our enemy. You can visit our website, manitoba.ca/COVID-19, for up-to-date information. And now I'm going to pass it over to Minister Goertzen.
Thank you very much, Dr. Roussin. Good afternoon to everyone who's in the room, those who are on the phone, and others who are watching online. It is a pleasure to be here with Dr. Roussin, and I would say to him, as I've said before, I want to thank him and his officials at Public Health for the work that they've been doing together with the Department of Education. It is not a new relationship. Public Health has always been involved with schools and with school divisions over the years for a variety of different issues, but obviously this is a little different and perhaps a bit more of an intense in terms of the relationship, but it's continuing on, of course, the work that they've done in the past with schools. There's going to be a lot of information given and more information given by Dr. Roussin when it comes to some of the health protocols that we'll be using as we return to school on September 8th. But not all of it will be able to be transmitted here in this press conference. But for those who are interested, on manitoba.ca/restoringsafeservices, so manitoba.ca/restoringsafeservices, you will find a lengthy document on provincial protocols, as well as a parent's guide that is a little bit easier for parents to access. And I know that parents, when I look at this now through a parent's eyes, and I am a parent who has a son who will be going to high school starting on September 8th, there are always lots of questions, as there should be. And I know that there's been lots of questions over the last weeks and months when it comes to returning to school. In trying to answer those questions, we've had great partnerships together with the many stakeholders in education, Manitoba Teachers Society, Manitoba Association of School Boards, the Manitoba Federation of Independent Schools, and the Manitoba Association of School Superintendents have all been at the table daily as we've worked towards protocols that are being released today. And I want to thank them for their input. Not that there's always going to be agreement on everything. That might be too high of an expectation, but certainly they've been fundamental and very important in getting us to this point today. It is important to think a little bit about where we've come from, of course. At the end of March, the announcement was made that in-school classes would be suspended. That was ultimately extended for the balance of the school year. Together with Dr. Roussin and Public Health, the decision was made, but also to give 1 week's notice at that point. And I know that there was concern then about the 1 week's notice. There was many absentees during that week, but following the advice of Public Health, it was the right decision, and giving that week's notice made sense both from a system perspective and also from a health perspective. Then as we moved closer to June, the decision was made with Public Health advice to go to a limited use of schools, where we welcomed back thousands of students into classes in a more limited way in June, one of three provinces to do that, together with British Columbia and Quebec, I believe. And while there was concern expressed at that time as well, that experience was successful. And I think it meant a lot to students and to teachers and to others to be able to welcome those thousands of students back into the classes in June. During this time, there's been summer school in many different schools, and so there are still and have been students accessing the school system. All that to say, there's been lots of preparation that's been happening since March on a lot of different things in terms of establishing and setting up schools and protocols within individual schools. We did, though, in June, talk about three scenarios and ask these school divisions to prepare for those three scenarios. They were busy during those summer months working on that. We were able to more closely identify the scenario that we would be in several weeks later. And together with these protocols, which they've been helping design together with Public Health, they've been refining their individual division and school plans. And so the questions that I've been getting, of course, from parents are, what are the overall provincial protocols and requirements? And those are being released today, and as I mentioned, are online to be viewed now. And then there'll be specific questions about, what about my son or my daughter's school? What does the class schedule look like? Where do they enter? Those sort of specific school and division level planning documents will be available next week. And so you can see there is a very systematic process to this. We've learned from things that happened in March. We've learned from the limited reuse of schools in June. We've been learning from summer school. We are now informed by the protocols, which are finalized today, which will then flow down to those individual school and division plans that will be released next week, about 3 weeks in advance of school reopening on September 8th, to give parents and teachers and, of course, students time to prepare for that. So again, it is with great thanks I say to Public Health and to others within the Department of Education and throughout the broader education system. It's been a summer like no other, and they've been working really hard daily behind the scenes. I know that there's always a desire to have new information put out every day, but the work happens behind the scenes every day to get to points like this where information can be provided, and of course then there'll be more of that specific information next week. So I know that Dr. Roussin wants to walk through some of the health protocols as it relates to school and today's announcement.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Minister. So specifically to schools, we'll speak a bit of the protocols being put forth. So physical distancing of 2 meters, six feet between individuals should occur whenever reasonably possible. When that physical distancing is not possible, then the use of cohorts can be used to limit the exposure and also facilitate contact tracing if required. Public health encourages the use of outdoor space as much as possible. Certainly the fundamentals are in place there. Regular hand washing, including assistance to younger children to ensure hand washing is done frequently. Good cough etiquette, coughing into the elbow, disposing of tissues properly, increasing the frequency of cleaning, disinfection, and sanitization will be a major component, especially on high-touch surfaces and in common shared areas. We provided advice regarding ventilation. Wanted to also mention that for grades 5 to 12, mask use is going to be strongly recommended when physical distancing cannot be obtained. It's going to be required for that group on buses. Those children will be encouraged to have their own non-medical mask, but mask will be provided should they not have their own. We know that we need to anticipate COVID-19 cases to occur in schools, and so we've been planning in that regard. So public health will work very closely with school administrators in identifying close contacts, notifying them and advising them to self-isolate. The areas of school where exposures took place will be cleaned and disinfected, and those areas will not be used again until it's determined safe to do so. School communities will be notified when a child in their school has a confirmed case, once those close contacts have been identified. And a closure of a school would be the last resort. All of these precautions that we are taking here is to minimize the number of one cases, but also minimize the number of students who would actually be a close contact. So certainly those who are close contact will be required to self-isolate for 14 days. But the idea is to not require the closure of an entire school should we start to see cases. And I think that's the public health news with as far as the protocol, so I can open up to questions.
Thank you, Doctor. We're going to go to the phone first. Up first will be Scott from the Winnipeg Sun.
Dr. Roussin, Scott Wood from Winnipeg Sun. We're strongly recommending, why not just mandate the mask? What is the apprehension here of mandating the mask when you're already strongly recommending?
Yeah, this has been the approach in Manitoba. We've made public health recommendations. Manitobans have largely stepped up and followed them. So at this point, we're strongly recommending it. And like in the past, we expect Manitobans to follow our recommendations. Things like mandating things are used for cases when it's required. So it's certainly not off the table. But we're going to go with a strong recommendation and follow it closely.
There's four or five children under 9 today that have contracted the virus, according to the release. I guess this question is, why not just take that extra precaution to mandate for school children, at least given the close proximity? Given they're already going to do it on buses, why not just do it?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that we're going to strongly recommend it. And if that doesn't work, then we could mandate it. But we're not back yet, and so we're going to rely on Manitobans to follow recommendations, which they largely have.
Up next from CBC Radio Canada, Ezra.
Hi. Actually, my question is a bit the same, but I would like to hear Mr. Goertzen regarding that mandatory putting the mask in a mandatory way. Because, I mean, there's a big debate right now, and even though you are strongly recommending the mask, I mean, it's still a bit free for all. I mean, people can do what they want. So I'm just wondering why the government wouldn't, like, decide to take, you know, like, a definitive position so the behavior would be of all the parents would be coherent to protect the children.
So I think that one of the successes that we can point to in Manitoba is that we've really been guided by public health advice. So whether that is advice that we're receiving here in Manitoba, it's also consistent with the advice, I believe, that comes from Health Canada on the strong recommendation. And I do think that Manitobans, and one of the reasons why we have been successful compared to most jurisdictions in Canada and in North America are more successful than those jurisdictions is because we're following that advice. And the approach in terms of recommendation, I think Manitobans have responded and have taken the precautions that are right for them and for their families. And continuing on with what made us successful so far, I think is the most likely way to make us successful in the future.
Okay. To make this all year your plan work, the parents will need the same flexibility from their employers that is asked from the education system. I'm just wondering, are you kind of a championing, you know, like defending the parents with your different colleagues, Mr. Pallister, you know, like we're starting up the economy, but I mean, are you making sure that, like, the other government authorities have this idea in their head that parents will need flexibility too?
I think that everyone in government and everybody within our caucus, and I would assume everybody within the legislature, understands that we need to be sensitive and understanding of the fact that we're in difficult and different times. And as I've said before, we're all in the same storm, but not everybody's in the same boat. And so there are families for whom this is going to be more difficult and more of a challenge. And Dr. Roussin, he talks about the fundamentals, of course, every day. But one of the additional fundamentals that I think he refers to is kindness. And kindness also extends to understanding those different circumstances that people are in. And so I think that businesses, by and large in Manitoba, have always looked at their employees as a valuable asset, their most valuable asset, want to maintain that valuable asset, and they will work with them to ensure that where there are difficulties as it relates to parents and the school system, our hope, of course, was that they would be flexible and understanding to that. And I do believe the Manitobans overall feel that we are truly in this together. It's not just a slogan. We sometimes see that demonstrated in very overt and obvious ways, but more often it's demonstrated in smaller ways, in neighbor to neighbor, in community to community. And so I think that that'll extend into the business community and otherwise.
Thank you, Minister. We now return to the news conference theater.
Minister Goertzen, in addition to the $48 million that was identified last time you were here, how much more money is the province prepared to offer schools, all of them, to help this pandemic plan work?
So, yeah, thanks very much for the question, Bart. So obviously, as we said in the last press conference, we would be working with school divisions to identify what their needs are. And they won't all be the same in every school division, but there was sort of a common request from the different school divisions when it comes to masks and providing of masks. And so they wanted to ensure that there was equity there and that there was availability within within the schools and the school system. So we are going to be providing those non-medical masks, reusable masks, or masks that can be used just one time, if that is required. So that is going to cost into the millions. We know that. There'll be additional asks, I'm sure, that are going to come from the school divisions as we go through that, and we'll continue to look at those needs. So we made the commitment that where there was sort of a demonstrated need, we would look to try to fill that need. This one came up. I think it's a different approach, though, than just throwing out a global number and saying there's going to be this pot of money and let's see how everybody wants to use it. It really is about what are your needs. Let's come to that agreement, and then we'll look to see how we can meet those needs. So this was the first one that was identified most clearly. There'll be others, I'm sure, but I think we've demonstrated we're willing to work with school divisions that will include providing additional funds.
We were told in the briefing that no specific money has been set aside yet for these school divisions, that they were first asked to use those savings from last year, then to start looking where they can cut expenses, and then come to the province. So do you guys have no money specifically set aside?
So I think there isn't a delineated dollar amount. So we're not saying there is $100 million that is sort of in a place that can be used. But as there are requests and needs, those things have to be paid for. And so when it comes to masks, I wouldn't be able to tell you exactly what the costs are, because we're not procuring them directly out of education. They'll be procured through central services, I would expect, but it will be in the millions. And so while there isn't so the answer was correct that you received this morning, while there's not a specific dollar figure on a global level, as there are costs that are necessary to incur and that there's agreement that it's needed for protecting students, we'll incur those costs.
So we were also told that parents who weren't necessarily comfortable sending their kids back to school, that's not a good enough reason to be able to distance learn. Can you just expand on that a little bit, on who would be allowed to distance learn and why maybe it's not okay if you're just not comfortable, why there has to be a specific health concern?
So for us, the comfort level when it comes to the school system and the protocols comes in working together with the school divisions and with public health. The school divisions have been working hard on plans. You're going to see those next week. All of those who are involved in the school system, they have one overriding goal, and that is they want to ensure that their students are safe. And so the combination of their efforts together with public health advice and direction provides that comfort for us. That doesn't mean that there aren't going to be cases of COVID in schools. There are cases of COVID in society, and our students live in society, but we need to be COVID ready. And the work with public health and the school divisions, I think, have given us that comfort that they will be COVID ready. As is always the case in the school system, Brittany, where a student can't go to school because of a medical reason, they are provided with the resources from the school division and their individual school, and that would be the case here as well. So if a student is self-isolating because they've been asked to self-isolate and they're awaiting a test result, they would be given the resources. Or if they have to stay home because they're immune compromised and that's been medically directed, then they would be given those resources as well. In terms of, there are different times and different reasons why parents have taken options to do different things. Within the public school system, within the Public Education Act, there are different options. And so parents can access the public school system, they can access the independent school system, they can access the homeschooling system. I think last year approximately 4,000 students were homeschooled in the traditional way of homeschooling. I'm not talking about sort of the emergency education system that happened in March. And so those have always been alternatives, but we are comfortable with the school system because of the work of the school divisions together with public health.
So is the recommendation, if you as a parent are not comfortable sending your child to school, that's not a good enough reason to be able to do distance learning, but maybe look at alternative options such as homeschooling?
There have always been alternative options that were accessible for parents who, for whatever reason, didn't feel comfortable sending their students to a public school system, or who just simply chose that form of education because they believe that it would be better for their son or daughter. That has always been an option that has existed in the Manitoba legislation. It's always been considered a viable and a valuable option, and that exists now in a pandemic, and it'll exist after the pandemic.
Minister, what gives you the confidence, given that we have seen positivity rates go from next to nothing to over 1.0%, and moderate case numbers announced daily for the past week and a half?
Confidence comes, Bart, from where it's always come from for me, and that is because we are listening to our medical experts and their medical advice. There have been different parts, different times in this pandemic where there have been significant concerns. And so I mentioned early on in my comments that when we chose to suspend in-class learning in March, there was that 1 week preparation period. We thought that that was valuable for parents and for teachers to prepare. And yet, if you go back and look, you'll see there was tremendous concern by many expressed about having that 1 week. And that was in some ways demonstrated within our school system. And yet the public health advice was right, and it was good at that time. And that week, from a public health perspective, I believe went well. We were also given advice from our health officials prior to going back in June in a limited use way. There were thousands of students who were welcomed back into school, so preparations were done already at that time in terms of flow and other things, and that went well. We were told that we could continue to have schools open for summer school and for day camps all through this summer. That's happening right now, where there are thousands of students who've accessed those schools for summer school or for day camps, and that's been informed by advice from public health. So as a parent, I have concerns too. That is not unusual. As I said, my son is going into high school this year, and of course, I think about these same things for him as well. So where do I draw my comfort? Quite apart from being the Minister of Education, I draw my comfort from, as a parent, from the fact that public health has led us extremely well up to this point in this pandemic. And there's no reason not to believe that their advice will not continue to be as solid as it's proven to be in the past.
I think part of the reason why parents have these concerns is because they keep hearing advice that don't enter indoor crowded spaces. However, your child is going to be going to school in a classroom where the classes haven't been capped, and that's something we've been hearing from the public health agency. We're hearing from SickKids these recommendations to reduce those class sizes. So what is, I guess, Dr. Roussin, do you want to comment on the class sizes?
Well, certainly some of the class sizes will be reduced in high school, and where we're not able to cohort. There's still the physical distancing that's required. The 2 meters may not be able to be achieved in all circumstances, but certainly there's distancing there, that minimum of 1 meter. We've had a lot of safeguards, right? We take that layered approach. So the important thing is we can't have any symptomatic teachers or students back in school. And we're going to take that very seriously. Hand hygiene, all these efforts. And now even on top of all those things, mask use. So we have a multi-layered approach right now offsets any of those issues.
And Maggie, to your question and to Dr. Reeson's point, I think you're going to find when the individual plans come out next week, then I mentioned this in the earlier press conference, the 2 press conferences, that one of the biggest challenges is going to be high schools, because almost every class in a high school, in many high schools, are electives. And so there is significant movement between students, and it's difficult to cohort. So when that cohorting can't be achieved, then there is a requirement for 2 meters, which I think the doctor has said in the past is really probably our best protection. And so I think you're going to see a high percentage of those high schools who are going to be doing the 2 meters, which is going to mean that there's going to be smaller class sizes in the group that the evidence might show where there's the highest potential for transmission. But that does mean that even though those classes or those schools will be open and there will be full-time learning, it might not always be every day in the school for those high school students. And we talked about that as a very real possibility in the two previous press conferences. And I think you're going to see that in the individual plans, that there are going to be many high schools where students won't be there every day. They'll be learning every day because there are going to be the expectations of what they need to learn when they're not in the class. But that there will be smaller class sizes as a result of that, because they will be achieving the 2 meters distance because they won't be achieving the cohorting.
What does that mean for parents, though, if you have high school students who are at minimum at school twice during each 6 day rotation? Parents have jobs. If you've got a 15-year-old or a whatever staying home, they're expected to have some sort of supervision for some capacity. If you've got 4 days a week that a kid is home by themselves, what do you say to those parents?
Well, I am one of those parents, and so obviously, you know, that is a challenge. And obviously, at a certain age, children are able to be home. But one of the things that we did say, and that I said 6 weeks ago, and that regardless of the situation, whether it is a high school student or whether it's busing, or whether it's the potential that a younger student might become sick with something that isn't able to be distinguished between COVID or other sorts of things, the flu season, and they should stay home, that there have to be plans made for that. And that doesn't, and that also involves, into an earlier question, working with your employer. The pandemic is inconvenient, and it will continue to inconvenience us for a while. And those preparations, I know as a parent, aren't always easy. But they have to be made. But I think that it's probably easiest in the high school years, where there is more ability for individual students to be able to be without a parent. It is easier in the high school years, clearly, than it would be if you're in the grade, you know, 2, 3, or 4 years.
Do you have an average of how many? You said two days a week, a minimum per rotation for high school students. Do you have an average right now of what we might be seeing?
So many high schools, even though they won't, some high schools will be able to go back full-time. Others won't have achieved that, but will be more than the 2 days. But you'll see the specific plans for the schools next week. And that is going to be, you know, really critical, obviously, for parents. I think that today's information, I hope, will give them comfort that we are following public health advice, and that there are specific standards that are across the province, but every school is configured a little differently. Every school has a different population within it. And so where they enter and how their recesses get staggered and how their classes get staggered, because even though, as Dr. Roussin has said, there's a strong recommendation in terms of wearing masks in those congested areas, that doesn't mean that there's not considerable effort happening now to make sure that those areas don't get congested. And that'll be staggering recesses, staggering classes. Tremendous effort has gone into those plans to making sure that wherever possible, there isn't that congestion. I mean, we've seen, obviously, and you'll have seen in different places in the world. And by the way, there are many places in the world where students have returned back to school, and they were back to school in the spring, and so there's been lessons learned from that as well. But the goal will always be to reduce that congestion.
What has significantly changed other than obviously going to a strong mask recommendation from your June moderate draft plan?
So I think that there are more details in terms of the protocols that exist within the plan. Certainly one of the questions that we needed to do a better job of answering for parents, and I think that this plan does, and it's other than questions around masks or whether or not students would be going back at all, probably the question that I've gotten the most from parents is, what happens if there's a case? So do I get notified if my child is in that school but maybe didn't have the close contact? What's our response? Has the entire school closed down? Does everybody have to self-isolate? Those are the kind of questions that were coming up, and they're legitimate and real questions for parents to have. And so this provides more advice in terms of the information we provided to that, to the individuals within the school, and there'll be more detailed advice provided, I think, in the daily briefings as well. So it's not about closing down an entire school system, but ensuring that information gets out to those who need to have the information, but also provides them assurance.
On that note, what tools other than contact tracing do you have to determine if the virus is spreading within the facility? Is that kind of the only way to tell?
The way we set up to prevent that and in the cohorts will help our ability to contact trace, but that's really how public health will do this. We will identify cases early, identify those close contacts. If we can't narrow it down, then it might be an entire cohort, but we're going to do whatever we can to do what we normally do, is narrow down those contacts as soon as possible.
And so if somebody within a cohort of up to 75 tests positive, then that whole cohort could potentially have to self-isolate?
Potentially. So we have a lot of these safeguards in that that would minimize the need for the entire cohort to go, but it certainly is possible that a cohort could have to self-isolate.
Do we have the bus capacity for all parents who need bus transportation to get it? I know earlier you said you were going to rely on the parents that could to drive their kids. For some, that's simply just not possible.
So we encourage parents that wherever possible, they should consider driving their son or daughter to school. But obviously, where they can't, we need to provide that service. And so I think that the ability to consider the bus itself as a cohort, so students who are on that bus are essentially themselves a cohort, is helpful. The ability, of course, to sit with a family member has been helpful. And the ability to sit on the bus, and these are all under the bus guidelines, which are linked within the document that's online. The ability to sit with others who are in your school cohort is also been helpful. So why school divisions initially indicated that might be one of their greatest barriers, and I wouldn't want to say that it's still not a challenge. We are hearing less concerns from the school divisions on the transportation than we were in June when they weren't necessarily being considered a cohort on the bus. But you'll get more of those details, of course, with the individual divisions. And for some divisions, it'll be more of a challenge than for others.
Moving over to Dr. Roussin here. Sorry.
Dr. Roussin has to leave in a few minutes. So any more questions?
For Dr. Roussin, I'm switching back to Brandon here right now. Maple Leaf is still my colleague in Fraser. Actually, it's 31 of its employees now that are have contracted COVID-19. We have seen Maple Leaf offer to buy masks for everyone in Brandon. Yesterday, the Premier said that he didn't believe the medical advice warranted asymptomatic testing, but federal regulations, as the opposition pointed out, actually do recommend asymptomatic testing when there's an outbreak at a meatpacking plant. So I have to ask you again why there is not asymptomatic testing at the business that you don't identify, which is Maple Leaf.
Right, so the if there is a transmission within a facility, an outbreak within there, then we, like we do now, is we test contacts, asymptomatic contacts. So we're doing that right now. So anyone who's an asymptomatic contact is offered testing. There just aren't any, isn't any transmission within the facility that we can identify right now. So throughout all of the Manitoba right now, asymptomatic contacts are tested.
So does that include everybody that might be living together, who works
for
together
sure.
at the plant?
Anyone who's identified as a close contact is offered asymptomatic testing.
And more on Brandon, forgive me, Brittany. The 67 cluster cases, are there more than 67 cases in Brandon in total?
Yes. I don't have the exact number because it's the we can continue to take numbers off there, but it's the vast majority of cases in Brandon are linked to that cluster. There are a few that are what we'd call that non-epi linked.
How many are not epi linked or community transmission, whatever term you prefer?
In Brandon, I don't have the specific one. So in our last 7 days, our non-epi linked cases are listed at 25 for the province. But as I mentioned, that's often an overestimate because cases that just haven't been investigated yet are lumped there.
The 25 are active cases, not our total cases.
That's the last 7 days, yes.
So you had three that were at the business Maple Leaf that you said that weren't necessarily connected to the cluster. Are those considered community transmission then?
No, they're linked to other cases in the community, just not happen to be in the that cluster.
Dr. Roussin, I can't help but note the ventilation guidelines are more robust than before. Can you speak to why this is more of an importance for public health?
So we know that that ventilation, when there's good ventilation, it decreases the likelihood of transmission of virus. That's why we talk about outdoor activities, right? There's essentially infinite ventilation. And so we wanted that to be part of a safer return to school. So we talk about things like avoiding the recirculation of the air, minimizing use of fans, increasing fresh air intake, whether that's through an HVAC system or through opening windows. So a number of recommendations just so that schools are informed on how they can have adequate ventilation.
Can you also tell us that grade 5 number? Some other jurisdictions are using grade 4. Why did Manitoba go with grade 5?
The most of the guidelines are age 10. And so we didn't want to do it by an age group where you might have half of a class wearing a mask and not. So we just we felt that age 10 was best reflected by grade 5.
Okay, maybe Minister Goertzen could be allowed to leave now if he has to go.
I
thought you said it was Minister Roussin.
Dr. Roussin.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
He's trying to help me on Bart.
Yeah.
Dr. Roussin, can I ask one more question?
Yeah, sure.
So we've heard from yourself and from Premier Pallister the fundamentals are what's going to get us through this. I'm going to mean being socially distant in school is going to be tough. Avoiding a large indoor gathering is virtually what a school is. Regular hand washing will become tough when you can't send all students to the bathroom at the same time. And there's high touch surface areas. So I mean, is a school sort of like, does it stand in the face of sticking to fundamentals if fundamentals are so important?
No, a few of those things that you mentioned are being addressed. So hand washing, right? So there's ways of organizing that without having to send all kids to the washroom at the same time. Sanitization, that we have protocols for that. So there's efforts in that. The distancing is achieved for the most part, you know, in hallways, there's protocols in place, so there's not crowding. We mentioned in high school, in the lower grades where transmission is not as likely, then the full 2 meters may not be able to be obtained. But there are all those protocols. That's why I take that layered approach. So I think the fundamentals are still there, and we're going to, you know, really watch that situation closely.
One last one for you, Dr. Roussin. The plan here, you're asking schools to control traffic and do what they can. And what do you say to teachers? You say, you know, it's like keeping kids in one place and getting them to follow directions is worse than herding cats. What do you say to teachers?
Well, I think the you know, it goes back to the, you know, engagement, and so we've engaged with the divisions, with education. So we provide public health advice. The plans, the specific plans, are being done by the people who know this best. So I would defer to some of their expertise on how they're going to manage these situations. I don't know.
Okay. Thanks, Dr. Kent. Maybe just a couple more for the minister and leave that back.
Yeah, Minister Goertzen, you said that you guys will be purchasing some PPE. There will be masks available for students who maybe can't afford to get them themselves or who parents don't have that accessible. Have you guys already put in any orders so far for shields or PPE at this time?
So the procurement will happen through central services. And so I believe in terms of shields, to the extent that they'll be used, that they have a significant supply within central services. The procurement of those daily use masks, or the procurement of the cloth masks, I believe will be undertaken at this point. And of course, as you mentioned, Brittany, I mean, we're now in a time when there are lots of families who already have this, and they'll have a reusable mask that their children might be wearing. I mean, I was in Costco last week, and you know, saw lots of people wearing masks, young people wearing masks, and so that's not an unusual thing at this stage of the game. But there'll be some who don't.
So is the idea the province is going to, or school divisions will have through the province, stockpiles of masks in their schools in case students need them and show up without them?
Yeah, so they'll have to be available, obviously, at the school, because even if students have masks of their own, students are students, they're still people, they forget, right? And so they might forget to bring their mask, and so there'll have to be some within the schools, and then some that'll be warehouses, stockpiled elsewhere in government.
I know there's been talk of ramped up mental health support, so can you speak specifically to what we can expect in schools when it comes to increased supports?
So there are supports, of course, already that exist when it comes to some wraparound services. There's True North Youth Foundation that's been doing work. We announced last week, continuing our relationship with Sheldon Kennedy's Respect in School organization. We'll continue to monitor to see what exactly the impact has been. It is difficult. We know that there'll be different mental health challenges, I think. Or at least we believe that. Maybe I shouldn't even say that we know that. Our expectation would be that there would be, right, because of what kids have gone through. But we're not sure entirely if that will result in necessarily more. And so we're certainly monitoring that. We have organizations that are already involved in the schools that we could scale up and do more of what they're already doing if need be. But we need to get a sense of what that looks like. And it's going to be difficult until we see students come back. Sometimes students and young people are more resilient than we think, but we're all living through this for the first time, and so we want to make sure that we have the resources in place. We do, but they're agile enough that they can be scaled up if we need more or altered if we need something different.
Do all schools have a nurse on, like, whether, you know, if a student starts showing symptoms, how will that be dealt with?
Yeah, I mean, certainly many schools have nurses. There are many schools, you know, to have many different resources when it comes to things that are outside of your traditional education system. I don't believe that every school would have a nurse, but certainly the divisions themselves would have that ability. And so they have the protocols that will be in place. That self-screening is being asked of parents to do with young people before they leave their homes, and then they'll be screening when young people get to school. That can be happen as well with teachers. So there'll be lots of screening. But, you know, I think the one thing about where we're at now that is different than where we were at in March is that a lot of these things have become common for society and people. So I know for myself, when I walk into a store, now one of the first things I do is I look down and I look for the arrows. Well, I wouldn't have done that back in March. And I know for young people and for students, they've sort of got this idea of social distancing in their mind. Not that they're going to do it perfectly, for sure, but they certainly have a better understanding of it than they did in March. And they understand that there's going to be directional sorts of things that was already happening to a large extent in June. And they would have seen that in some schools. And those who are in summer school or in other sort of day camps will have seen that in their schools already. So for some, I think that there's this feeling that, you know, the lights have been off for 5 months, and now we're going to turn the lights on September 8th and see how this goes. There's been a lot of this that's been happening already with the partial reopening of schools, summer schools, day camps. Much of this has been happening now for months already.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Wait, I do have one last one. Please. Minister, I suspect that a lot of the school divisions are just going to take your strong recommendation and say, no, masks for everyone, and that's up to the divisions, I assume. What would you say to people, and I'm seeing a lot of commentary on the unscientific sample that is social media, what would you say to someone who's concerned that the lack of the mandate might encourage the possibility for bullying between people who do or don't wear masks?
So, first of all, when it comes to any kind of bullying, and I'm really glad you asked this question, Bart. It goes a little bit to what Dr. Roussin talks about kindness, but when it comes specifically to masks, first of all, don't take your scientific advice from social media. We take our scientific advice from public health. So I'm also on social media, and sometimes I regret that decision, but I see lots of things, and I hear lots of things, and I get lots of messages from people who believe to be experts in the medical profession. But we listen to our chief provincial health officer and public health, because not only are they truly medical professionals, they're medical professionals in the Manitoba context. And so even if some things might be true in a different context or a different place in the world, that doesn't necessarily mean that they fit into the Manitoba context. When it comes to masks, though, you're right. Because it's a recommendation, you're going to see different things. And I would say the same thing to students that I would say to anybody else in society. If you see somebody wearing a mask, that is something that you should treat respectfully. And if you see somebody who is not, we don't know their individual circumstances in terms of why they may not be wearing a mask. And so I think that you should treat them respectfully. The best thing that we can do in a pandemic, when there's lots of emotion, and I experience those emotions as well, is to be kind, to be respectful, to try to put yourself into another place, person's shoes, and when you can't, remember that they may be experiencing something that you might not know on the surface or in the face of it. So I would say that to all the students as they're going back, not just on the issue of masks, but there are a lot of young people who will have gone through a lot of difficult things when the school were closed for in-class learning, and let's be respectful of each other. Because that, I think, will be one of the best things we can do and that we'll remember when we're on the other side of the pandemic. Thanks for asking that question, Bart. Thanks, everybody. It was good to see you. Hope you have a great rest of the afternoon.
Thank you. And thanks for answering that one.